Hi everyone, welcome to the Data Scientist podcast. Today we're very happy to have with us Andy Zambito from Creatio. Hi Andy.
Hi, how are you?
Really glad to be here. I'm great, thanks. Thanks for joining us. I think it might be a bit early for you. You're based in Texas, right?
Oh no, I've been up working several hours, but yeah, I'm here in Austin, Texas, kind of the tech hub of Texas right now, and really happy to be on with you and your audience.
Awesome. Yeah, there are many things that must be happening over there. So it would be great to talk about that. So why don't you introduce yourself? You're probably going to make a better job at it than I'm ever going to do.
Sure. So I'm Andy Zambito. I'm currently the chief sales officer of the Americas for Creatio. And, you know, it was interesting. I've looked at, you know, many of your other podcasts, and I promise to make it as interesting for your audience as possible. My background, while we're talking about sales and the rest, I've been in and around, I think, more your world at various stops in my career, where one of my first and most challenging sales jobs was selling artificial intelligent decision support system with neural networks and the rest, when you're trying to unpack the black box of recommendations, when I had nothing to show, nothing to demonstrate, and I could just kind of take my word for it, and you'll have to wait for the results down the line, but it's going to be great. So that was a great early stop learning sales, but obviously we've all seen the rise of data science and machine learning in all aspects, including my world of sales.
Hey, that's fascinating. What year was that?
Oh my gosh, you're going to date me here. I think that was probably saying 1999, 2001, somewhere in there. It was right around the time the bubble was bursting. It was you know, custom solutions focusing on whether it was, you know, retailers looking to get beyond, collaborative filtering, or early days of online, you know, casinos and regular casinos looking at how do they make the right offer to the right person at the right time to motivate the right behaviors, and or even like check guarantee. Somebody writes a check at midnight at a gas station. Huh. Do you accept it or not? It was fascinating things, but I said it really put the sales test skills out there when, you know, that's what you were operating in. So I have a deep appreciation for what you and your audience do.
Yeah, glad to hear this. And the reason I ask you to elaborate is because, you know, I'm also selling services as a data scientist, from data strategy down to implementation. Yeah. And selling data science and machine learning is usually not that easy, right? Most people don't really understand what's happening. It's one of the reasons I started this podcast. And it seems that you've been doing this for longer than most people have, right?
I guess
which
so,
is actually
yes.
Quite impressive.
Well, thank you. It's a new era now, right? I mean, so lately, you know, I think 20 years ago, it was the realm of, you know, deep science of, like I said, neural networks and black box technology. Over the years, we've tried to unpack that, and we've seen the rise of more pure data science. And now I think we're starting to see what I would think of more as the consumerization of that, right? If you think about what we do at Creatio, it's all about taking things that were once technologically super difficult, right? Think about developing applications. And taking that to a no-code realm where a business professional can build an application or automate manual workflows or complex processes. And a big part of that has to be the data science, right? We've all grown up over the last 20 years to appreciate the value of data. But it's been this mystery of, you know, some really smart people in another room of the building that are doing all this, when I think we've lost the appreciation that we're interacting with the results of data science every day. And so now I think we'll start to see people becoming more comfortable engaging with it themselves.
So can you elaborate a bit on what Creatio is doing, and maybe on the history of the company itself? Like how long have you guys been around? I know the company is based in Boston, which is another major tech hub, but you operate in many different cities. So I'll be very interested to hear more about this.
Sure. I appreciate that. Well, we're a global company. We're about 650-700 employees on a global basis across five different offices around the world. And I think it's important to understand our vision, right? So for us, it's all about creating a world where everyone can automate business ideas in minutes. And the kind of problems that we're out solving for are, if you think about, you mentioned tech hubs, right? But every company, no matter what you're doing now, really needs to be on some level a technology company. And there's a high demand for applications, personalization, regardless of what industry you're in. And so we talk about this in generalized terms of digital transformation, right? Organizations are all going through various stages of that, but and that includes process automation and customer experience. And the problem we're solving also is not only to do that, but to do that in a world where there's a shortage of these deep technical resources to build it, right? If you think that's one point, I'll throw numbers because your audience is numbers based. If there's 1.7 billion knowledge workers out there today creating a demand for roughly 500 million applications, and then you recognize there's only 25 million software developers on the planet, there's no way for the current model to keep up with that. Now, that's why you have the advent of low-code and no-code technologies. Where Creatio applies them is we have that up software platform around that, but it's to bring that to customer experience, digital transformation, automation of workflows. Mm-hmm. And that's where we focus and essentially what we do. And to not just make that the realm of technologists, certainly they can use our solution, but to push that out into the business. Mm-hmm. And to go further to what we were saying earlier, that does include the ability to leverage machine learning and AI, maybe not at the same degree that you and your audience are doing in some practical purposes, but when you think about customer experience, as we mentioned, whether you are dealing with a financial services institution or your telco provider and you're on the help desk with them for something and you're threatening to leave and they're like, hey, but if we made you this offer, right? The technology behind that that's making that, it tends to be machine learning and AI. Mm-hmm. Now imagine if you, as a business analyst, could think of your next greatest idea and leverage that. So whether it's, how do I intelligently route my service calls? How do I score and manage my leads? How do I interact with this customer and make the appropriate offer? These are all areas of machine learning and AI that we empower to our users.
And I think that you guys call yourselves a low-code, no-code platform. So I think this is a very nice buzzword, and I think it's one of the main trends that we're going to see in the next few years. And I think it would be good if you could maybe share a few insights about this space and where do you see it heading in the next few years, but also how you in Creatio take advantage of this.
Yep, I'm happy to. So you're correct. This is a massive wave movement. So like all wave movements, you start to get the buzzwordy nature of it. So if you're not already hearing it, you'll probably start hearing it everywhere with technology providers. That doesn't mean that everybody's doing it, but it means that it's catching on. And one of the primary reasons is what I mentioned before about that delivery challenge. So Gartner, who's a major analyst in the software world, has predicted that 65% of business applications will be built on low-code, no-code in just the next handful of years, 2 to 3 years. So in technology terms, that's literally right here upon us around the corner. And what it essentially is saying is, if you think about kids at home today are doing things in Minecraft and Roblox, they're building things you can at home start your own home business, have a website up and be e-commerce ready without now knowing how to do any JavaScript or anything else. Those are examples of low code, no code. So now what Creatio is doing is applying that to the business world. And we're doing that with this technology platform, as I mentioned, right? So that is the foundational layer and it's part and parcel of everything we do. So if you build a customer experience engine on top of this, like CRM as an example, right? Which we have an industry leading one. If you, perhaps your audience has, just to make this relevant, if they've ever had to use a CRM solution of any type, and you ask them, how easy is it to change that or make a modification? Extremely difficult, painful, costly, if it's even possible at all. This is now a world where it says, this turns it back into an enablement technology. And it says, I want to experiment and iterate quickly. Just like you're going to run and train models, right? And you're going to augment them and retrain them. You need to be able to do that in your business if you want to be innovative. And what that means is I have to be able to do it at speed and at low cost. Otherwise, I'm out of the game, right? I'm not going to be able to keep up with the pace of innovation or keep up with the pace of consumer expectation. And so this is the world we live in. I'm not sure if I'm fully answering the question for you, but we're passionate about it here. So I can kind of keep me on the rails if I go off. But that's an area where we see explosive future growth. If you are locked in a technological environment where all of your newest and greatest ideas, all the things that are going to really move your business, whether it's, I want to be more efficient internally, I want to deliver something faster, I want to have a different engagement with my customer, and you're limited by your technology, your infrastructure, your tech stack, that's going to be, that's where you see the opening for new competitors. And an example of that is banking, right? If you look at traditional banking and how it struggled against now modern fintechs, like the Robin Hoods of the world who can come in and say, you can trade stock options by tonight. And we'll, you know, you might not even know what a stock option is when you start the application and you do it all through an app. You're not going to a branch. You're not filling out paperwork. You're not signing waivers. You're not doing all these things. You're doing it all electronically on an app and it's easy.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's the world that, that we enable you know, where we focus.
So what are the main use cases for you guys? CRMs is obviously one. Mm-hmm. I'd like to know what other types of use cases you tackle. And also, is it more like a platform? I don't personally have as much experience with low code. So is maybe because I'm coding.
Yeah, absolutely.
So is it more about getting, let's say, pre-existing apps and recipes, and then you plug them these in and then somehow Salesforce can do something different, or is it something else? And I guess besides CRM, you know, I asked you if you have any other use cases. I've been
interested to hear how
you can join many different types of processes, right? Maybe from telephone to, I don't know, customer support to all kinds of things.
That's exactly right. So if you think about, and CRM is a broad spectrum, right? It's everything from how do I attract, acquire, transact, service, and support my customers. But beyond that, you're absolutely correct. So where do we play? We play in the world of complexity, right? And so where we shine is that the greater that complexity that you have. Now that can be between departments interacting with each other. It can be between customers and back-end data that's in a lot of disparate sources. So you've mentioned obviously some, you know, that are very obvious primary use cases, like I have sales, marketing, service, all those areas. But the industries we serve are all of the primary ones you think of, right? Because there's no industry that's kind of safe right now from not having to adapt in a digital transformation way, and that includes manufacturing, logistics. That's not just your pharmas and your telcos and your life sciences, all the other financial services. So when you then say what are those use cases, you were on the money when you talked about. Process related, right? So the more process intensive you are, you tend to have a lot of things that are manual. You have a lot of friction built in. And this is a way to automate that out. Now, it doesn't have to be, it can be even on a corporate service level, right? How do I handle my employee recruitment and onboarding all the way through to, you know, customer account management and onboarding? But it can be as granular or as expansive, right? So we work with organizations that are global in nature, trying to completely transform how they do their operations. And we have others that are saying, look, I have this explicit pain around professional services organization and how I'm allocating my people and how do I understand their utilization and how I allocate them, right? Mm-hmm. All the way from that to how do I do debt collection and run those processes in different ways in order to engage with the folks where they are in a more meaningful and impactful way and make that a painless process on both ends. So it's not just, this is truly a platform, right? And it is, we call it Creatio because we want you to kind of think of it in terms of creation. But it's not a single like point solution. Like we do one thing, you have one pain, we connect the dots and it's over. It's usually a lot more complex. Now, what's really exciting about this is our conversations tend to start around, I have this particular problem, whatever it might be, right? It could be any of those things I mentioned, right? In a medical field, right? I've got my field going around interacting with folks and they don't know how to, you know, data science and the rest, how do I intelligently route them, right? To do their stops. And they start in this one area, but then they instantly see the ability to expand beyond that. Well, wait, I can also apply that here. I have this more friction over here. And so it's about achieving that operational excellence and moving towards that while helping them become faster and more nimble along the way. So hopefully that's a fair answer. I know it's not as simple as we do one thing because we can apply to all of these. But when you mention like that CRM, for example, that's where we're a leader in that space because it's a well-known one and there are a lot of pains and challenges that we you know, remove right out, right? The ability to see your customer from 360 degrees out of the box and to adjust what you do and how you interact with them. And how can you apply things like data science that aren't these big mega projects that take months of analysis to do? Can we put that in place quickly and experiment with it?
So if I understand correctly, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that most of your customers must be big organizations and they must be facing challenges around digital transformation. So I guess one of the benefits of using a low-code, no-code solution is that it can provide some new kind of plumbing, whereas if you didn't use the solution, then the option would either be to have a human do that thing manually, or it would be to, I don't know, contact three different software providers and ask them to make changes which somehow will work with each other, which is more difficult.
I realize I didn't answer one of your previous questions as well. So first, I'll just I'll dissuade you from the idea that it's only big companies. We actually, what's great about this technology is it scales from the smallest couple person operation that's looking to be more efficient all the way to the top Fortune companies. So it does.
Okay, so the cost is not an issue. Yeah, so if I want to use this, for example, let's say for my consultancy, it's not like because we're, let's say, a five people company, the cost is prohibitive or anything like
that. We serve as SMB all the way up. Now, my teams that I'm focusing on, obviously, we are spending our run more in the enterprise space, but as an organization, we serve for all that. And you also asked kind of what is the environment like here, right? So if you're a technologist, certainly we'll expose more to you. If you're not, you have the ability to drag and drop. And think of this as you're building composable apps. You have all of these broken down Lego parts, even if you will. If I can draw, think of work, if you're trying to automate workflows, if I can draw it on a chart on the flow chart on the whiteboard, I can actually click on these areas and I can empower each of those nodes and directions and things with simple clicks of what I want to do, whether that's, you know, something complex, more complex for a business person, like calling a web service to, I want to route to this person, create subroutines. I want it to, but a business user can do this. I want to alert you of this. I want it to take this action, transform this data and move through that. That's an example of the workflow process. But if I want to create my screen for an app and I want to interact with you and I can do this in a drag and drop format or fashion. And if I am a developer like yourself and I want access more to a little bit of an IDE, that's why you have this difference between low code and no code, right? The ability for you to get in there and do more. I don't want the audience to be thinking about this as a limiting technology. It's actually quite the opposite. I think the instinct for a developer might be to think, oh, is it going to restrict me? It's the opposite. It's not going to, but it's going to make you faster, more efficient. And even those widgets that you build can be reusable as well, so that you have this composability to keep moving at speed.
Yeah, this makes sense. And in terms of the general low-code, no-code trend, what other trends do you see besides, you know, CRM and connecting different systems? I think I've seen some contenders for the space of creating apps without code. And my feeling is that many of those companies, initially, they started by promoting the services as something that someone would use for an MVP. But I believe that many companies actually want to move everything towards the low code, no code domain, where eventually you will be able to create iPhone apps without code, data science pipelines without code, pretty much anything really, right?
No, you're right on the money. That's the trend. And I'll tell you that our technology is operational. This is not to build as an MVP. I was talking to a firm earlier this morning who is, you know, has built themselves to a massive success level. They work with the world's largest companies in financial services, and they believe that they're one of the reasons they're being drawn to low code, no code is they want to, and why they selected Creatio to do this is they wanted to redo all their operations. They wanted to take all these things that have been built over time, custom or bespoke or third party, and have that in an area where they actually could impact it in a fast and meaningful way. Because they recognize that their key differentiator in the market, their you know, special sauce for what they did was in their heads, right? The things that they're bringing to the table and how they want to approach this and how they can run new things. And frankly, the technology was way more limiting, right? It's like building, I think the way they described it to me is you're building a house and they built this custom house more and more and you can kind of, but eventually it's going to get crushed under its own weight. Yeah. And you can keep adding on rooms as well, but eventually you run out of things to do, and they're not really connected. So I think you're absolutely right that this trend we see, I mentioned the one about as a delivery mechanism, we just have to do it, right? There's no way to keep up with demand. You have no choice but to do this. But the reality of the benefit is you get all of the advantages of, say, what custom software used to promise without the negatives, right? It's tailored to what you need, but without the cost and the burden. Mm-hmm. You get all the advantages of off-the-shelf software, of it being enterprise-grade, stability, you know, hosted in places like Amazon and Azure and all those things, or on-premise, all the things you could expect. It's industrial strength, but you're not limited by the vendor's roadmap or anything else, because that's not what you're beholden to, and making sure there's alignment there, and you're not making a sacrifice that we're only going to get 70% of what we want in order to go down that path. Mm-hmm. I think this combines with the other trend of the emerging workforce, right, that's coming in, has a very high expectation of what technology enables them to do in their personal lives. And then they come to the office and suddenly they're greatly restricted, or worse, you're in a home office. So I'm over here on my personal side, I can do anything under the sun, super easy, super fast. And I get to the business and I have all these roadblocks of why I can't do anything that I know should be possible and capable. So there's an internal demand to make this shift, and there's an external demand by customer experience that we talked about driving companies to do this. And we're at a point at the perfect storm, right? With the pandemic, I think it also elevated for everyone what it really means to become a digital first company or to mm-hmm. innovate. If you can't fly your planes and open your doors and sell merchandise or the rest, how do you still hit your numbers? How do you still grow?
Yeah, this makes perfect sense. So one more thing I'd like to ask you before we close. Please. Is, there are many people on the audience that are interested in entrepreneurship and startups. And I understand the company is based in Boston and you're based in Austin. So I think they're both major entrepreneurial hubs. And I heard some people saying that maybe Austin is a contender for stealing San Francisco's position. I'm not sure. I mean, I don't have much visibility to the West Coast, to be honest with you, even though I do have some people I'm working with there. Most of my, audience and business partners are in the UK, Europe, maybe East Coast. So I was really curious to hear your opinion about where you see the entrepreneurial ecosystems of both cities heading towards to. And also, what's really the deal with Austin?
Sure, man. I'm happy to talk to you. So the reality is I do know something about this, because I moved to Austin from Silicon Valley, where I was prior. And I can tell you this has always been a technology way back in the day. This is where Dell was founded. So it has early technology roots. It's also a university city and has different economics than, say, California. And as there's been a democratization of funding instruments too. So either you've been to Silicon Valley and you know all those people, so it doesn't matter where you are, they know you, or there's a lot of investors coming from other markets now that their money is equally of interest, that you don't necessarily have to be there for that. And the economics in San Francisco are quite tremendous for organizations trying to get started. So when you think about the big trends that are moving, as you're seeing, so Apple is creating a second U.S. headquarters. They're doing it in Austin. Tesla is creating a new major factory. They're doing it in Austin. Oracle is moving their headquarters from Redwood City. They're moving it to Austin. So you also have different, sort of this economic conditions like, no state income tax that's attractive to businesses. There's also a high, pool of talent. And for your audience, like University of Texas has a data science program. So you're seeing folks say, I can recruit out of a different university in a different market. Mm-hmm. I have, maybe less expensive real estate, lower cost of the employees. And that'll quickly change as these cities grow. Yeah. But I think there's a, democratization, and you're seeing these kind of second city uprising, right? You'll see this in, the Denver Boulder area. You see this, it's always been, Raleigh Durham has been a big market, Salt Lake City. Cities that you don't normally associate with, being Silicon Valley, it's a big transformation, and they'll find their funding. So no longer do I think you need to. Now, I'm not going to take away, I'm a big fan of Silicon Valley. I lived out there for years, have a lot of friends that work out there, and it's a phenomenal market, but it's not the only market. And so I would suggest to some of your audience, if they're in the startup business, that don't feel restricted by just doing that.
That's great to know. So I think that post-COVID, we're still kind of during COVID, but you know, I hope everyone understands what I mean. I think the space has opened up. So I think many hubs, which were, let's say, secondary in nature, they are growing. And I guess that's positive because you get, you know, more variety, more people. You don't want everything to be concentrated in one place, right? Because like you said, the economics can be a bit challenging, especially for startups and young founders. Yeah.
It was always, you know, so Boston, New York, DC, San Francisco, these markets, and they still are absolute, you know, meccas of technology and funding and startups and big established companies. So not to take away from them, but yeah, you're going to now, I think you'll start seeing this all over. And COVID actually only just enhances that when people have realized that they don't have to, not all roles have to physically collaborate in person. Mm-hmm. And so you'll see that change as well. I don't think I'm making any predictions there. I think that's just already, you know, evident. But
Yeah, I guess that's an interesting dynamic there, right? Like how many companies will actually choose a location because, you know, it's easy to source candidates or the office space is cheap or whether investors are there, because some of those things now have become a bit more flexible. I think that location will still play a role to some extent. I think it remains to be seen in many cases, right? I don't know how you guys work at Creatio. Like, did you find that you became more flexible post-COVID or, you know?
Yes, I'll tell you that, you know, obviously folks are, in my world, right, in sales, you know, they're interested to develop those relationships and be in front of people as much as you can. But obviously we've all adjusted to the video world as well, like we're meeting here today. We did on our end, you know, we changed from hiring directly into our office locations to opening up to remote work and hiring people in more, you know, disparate locations, not attached to a physical office. Absolutely something that we've seen change. While at the same time, we still remain hiring in those local markets for a variety of reasons. I mean, we based in those cities for a particular reason, but it hasn't become restrictive, right? We were able to quickly adjust and say, let's create these at home work policies. Mm-hmm. Let's you know, open up our let's get the talent where it is. And I don't think my prediction was in the general sense of business. I don't see that you know, changing. I think people will go back to offices, but not every role. And you know, because while for some people staying in, it'll be interesting to see. So for some folks, mm-hmm. staying at home and being locked in was a curse. For others, it was a blessing. And I think we'll have to see how that shakes out still as everybody starts to emerge from, you know, from this, and hopefully it's very soon, right? I know there's a lot of places around the world that are still being, you know, heavily hit, but I hope that's our next discussion and challenges. We're on the other side of this and we can understand how everybody adjusts.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's a great point. Great. Good stuff. Well, thank you, Andy. Any closing remarks?
No, I really appreciate you having me on. I'm happy to have more discussions. And if anyone or your audience would like to reach out to me, you can find me on LinkedIn, Andy Zambito, or a.zambito@creatio.com.
Amazing. Thanks a lot, Andy. And thanks, everyone, for listening to us. And make sure to check out thedatascientist.com for more content around data science, AI, and blockchain. Thank you.